Hello, everybody. It's Lumi here for Instra, and today it's my turn. It's been a while since I have done a video with you, and today's topic is a video that me and Michele have been talking about off camera. Pardon the mess here. We got to organize the studio a bit better, but today's topic is old souls. Now, what started this topic was we were watching a video on BuzzFeed Violet. Now, if anybody watches YouTube and you watch BuzzFeed, there are several channels. One of the channels is called BuzzFeed Violet. And the video was about is the struggles of being an old soul. Now, BuzzFeed, I think, did a somewhat halfway decent explanation of an old soul in the allotment of the video time, but unfortunately enough, they didn't answer a lot of questions I wanted to talk about. And the first thing is what is an old soul? To understand the concept of an old soul versus a new soul, I'm going to keep this simple. And what I mean by simple is we're going to compare your chronological age to the concept of old and young, okay? Newborn would be a new soul, or in this case, in comparison, okay? Never had experiences in this life. You had never had done anything in this life. You don't even know how to. You never worked. You never did anything. You still poop in your diapers. You still basically pee in your diapers. You still are suckling from your mom's teats. And you have no experience, okay, with the world around you. Except for the immediate areas of the basic comforts that mom provides for you as a newborn baby. Now, as you get older, you gain experiences such as, you know, going to school, and then maybe getting a part-time job after school, playing sports. And maybe when you get older, you go to college. Or maybe you don't. Doesn't matter. And eventually you settle down. And most people have a family at one point in their life. And then after that point, you have grandchildren. And by the time you're getting older chronologically, so I can't call you a newborn anymore because you're not new. So by the time you're 40, you are experienced enough that you now can say and be giving advice to other people. So that would be at that point we would say you're old, which is not meant to be negative in this connotation. It means that you have experience, you've been there, you've been through it, you've been through the block, around the block a few times. Well, when you're talking about new soul versus old souls, old souls have had at least one prior life before coming here. Now, Sylvia Brown pointed out, and I'm going to stand behind this because she's absolutely right, most all the people on Earth now are old souls. There is very few new souls coming to Earth. Even the star children are old souls. There's no reason for any soul to come here. The few that do, that were already souls, they just never came to Earth before. So, all souls are created by Mother and Father God, the Divine Masculine and the Divine Feminine. And so, for that reason, we all technically are the same age. It's just that the old souls have been here before. They went through it. They've been around the block. They know what's going on. They have experiences under their belt. At the young souls may not have, or maybe, you know, they may not realize that they're old souls themselves. Because remember, like I said, most old souls are the ones are still coming back here to Earth. The young souls are choosing to go often to other places for reasons that Earth is, unfortunately, is not in the best of condition right now, politically and financially and morally. Okay, I'm not going to get on my soapbox and talk about that stuff because Michele can do plenty of that. Yes, I could. Now, one of the things about being an ill soul is, as I said, we've been here before. We know that this is not the first time. So a lot of times, there's a lot of bleed-through experiences that we remember from our prior lives that we bring back to the table as we need them. We don't always remember everything from the prior lives. Michele, for example, I mentioned this about Michele's ability to wash laundry with her hand. But Michele also has other old-school talents as well. She knows how to light a kerosene lantern. She knows how to prime a gas stove. She knows how to light pilots. She knows how to do a lot of skills. And she has some skills with homeopathic medicine and a variety of talents that makes it really wonderful to be here, because if you know Michele, you could learn a lot. In fact, that's something else I should bring up, is old souls, because of their nature, attract young new souls to them, almost like followers. They old souls are extremely, how do I put this? They're just something about their charisma and their personality. It just attracts the young souls that want to learn most of the time. But unfortunately, some old souls are also not quite the best teachers in the world either. There are some old souls that are just really just as new at things as kids, as the youngsters are. Why is that? Well, because, you see, you've only been on this earth once before. Technically, it would be considered an old soul, but doesn't mean you experienced old soul. Michele is experienced old soul. She's been here 33 times. This is her 33rd time. This is my 31st time. So I look up to Michele a little bit because she's got a little more skills in certain areas than I do. And we work together. But the most important thing is with being, we're both old souls, technically speaking. But Michele's got a few more skills than I have. She grew up in the Midwest of the United States at the time of the frontier. She also was wife of a rancher in Montana. She had a lot of skills for homesteading, which I don't have because I grew up in the city in Kampi in Finland. That's very different situation. You have two completely different backgrounds and they get together. And yet, we also have been together a few other times in our lives and experiences and things. But those two divergent pasts come together now in the 21st century. And the reason why it comes out to be really useful information is that there are things that we can teach each other. And young souls are always seeking to learn the new things. But the problem with the young souls is they find the old souls a little difficult to grasp, because even though BuzzFeed was kind of making it lightly, talking about Sarah being an old soul, if you think about what it is to be an old soul, as I said, you've been around the block, you know what's going to happen. You know where you've seen things, you know how the rules work and how law works and all that. It's been there before. So sometimes the young souls look at the old soul as, depending on, the old souls are usually wise, are considered wise, and not always. Sometimes we're just as messed up as the kids are. Michele and I have certainly do like to have fun, and we do have fun. But Michele also has enough experience for things to know how to keep alive and keep healthy. It's kind of like the old adage, what's about the engineer's hatch? I don't remember exactly what it goes like this. Oh, I don't remember the exact adage, so I'm going to put it modern technology, as I understand it. There is no young, adventurous, there's no, well, let me explain what it's about, because I can't remember the exact adage, it goes like, something like this, is that in engineering, especially electrical engineering, is how come there's older, successful engineers that have survived some potentially dangerous situations is because of the fact is that they know that they have to be careful and they have to practice safety. Whereas young engineers, they're kind of daring and willing to live by the seat of their pants. Many of them, unfortunately, have faced their demise from electrocution or explosions or things like that. So basically what they're saying is the older engineer, the reason why he's still alive and healthy is because he's been practicing conservative safety techniques to do what he needs to do while protecting his ass. You understand the part? Yes, I do. Okay, it's the same with everything else. Your old souls that have been on this earth have had very long lives. They were careful. They practiced, conservative skills that were not daring and risky behaviors. They were, in other words, they knew what they needed to do to stay alive and stay healthy. Whereas, unfortunately, there were also some old souls that were still old souls, but they were still daredevils. They were still doing stupid things, and constantly, year after or life after life after life, they have short lives, and they end up dead. But they're still old souls now, because they've been there before. So why do we call them the daredevils, old souls? Because they are old souls. But why? Okay. We look up at them. Well, they look up at them for the same reason we look up at the conservative old souls, because they've been there, they've been around the block, and they're going to keep repeating the stupid stuff, and they're never going to get more experience. But even then, after you get zapped by, say, 240 volts enough time across your fingertips, you know damn well that what you don't touch, that big electrolytic capacitor that happens to be sitting in the circuit board after you pull out the mains plug, because that thing is going to sting you unless you properly exercise due care and discharge the cap. Old soul engineers know that, so that they always are grabbing a 10 kilo ohm resistor and putting it across the two legs of the capacitor to discharge the high voltage to avoid that nasty surprise. It's the same thing with anything else. I mean, if you work around machinery and you know that if you're working, say, around motors, pulleys, gears, and things like that, and you're going to wear a loose dress or skirt like I'm wearing right now, is that all of a sudden you're going to end up finding yourself inside the machine. Instead of working on it, you'll be in it, wrapped up, caught up, tangled up, mangled up, in some cases, depending on what the machine does. And that's not a very nice way to go, trust me. No, it's not. So the point is that those people will have to go through life a few times so they can eventually master the recommended practices of do's and don'ts. And the young souls, of course, sometimes love the daring old souls, even though they, these daring old souls may have had very short lives. They were adventurous. They were willing to try new things, but unfortunately, because of lack of conservative behaviors, they ended up kind of having short lifespans. That happens a lot. But you wanted to talk about also the other things too. Yeah, I want to talk about why is it that young souls always look up to old souls? The reasons we just mentioned. That's true. Because, you see, today's kids, and I think you'll agree with me on this, today's kids have absolutely boned themselves, the whole world, in this nanny society. Almost everything has become nanny-proof. I mean, look around you. Everything today is like got plastic guards on it and shields and safety nomenclatures and safety switches, and most people, most dangerous thing that a young person is going to probably run into is their car and maybe the kitchen stuff, the cooker. That's it. That was everything else is safety proofed, you know? Whereas the old souls like me and you, we worked with moving belts and open fire the things that could easily mangle us and shred us. And we know, for example, if we're working around such a motor, is we don't want to leave our dress hanging out waiting for that big flywheel to grab it and then take us and pull us into the machine as well. So we usually would tuck it up. But these kids don't really have any knowledge of that. They just think they look at the machine and go, ooh, it's cool. Can I play with it? And then they find out at the hard time it's... That was a mistake. That was their last mistake. However, an old soul that may be working with that machinery may be also physically a very young person. That's true. Let's talk about that. Your chronological age does not make you an old soul or a young soul. No. There are old souls that are a year old. They come back to babies in this life. But they're old souls. You can see it in their eyes. Their eyes say, I've been here. This is not my first time. I know what's going to come up next. I know what's going to happen to me. I'm going to take on the challenge. Hoorah, let's go. And yet, you got the young souls that could be, I mean, if they're lucky and they didn't end up getting killed by their own stupidity, they might be literally be about 50, 60 years old, and they still are basically young souls because they only had this one life. They are, you can see in their eyes, they're excited. They're like, oh, I'm going to try this. I'm going to try that. And they try it. And yet they don't realize that maybe sometimes that maybe they should go ahead and ask for some advice before they do certain things. And then they end up in the emergency room or worse. That's important to remember is you can be an old soul or you can be a kid. You can be a young soul and you can be an old geezer. It doesn't matter if it's chronological age. That's not what makes you a young or old soul. What makes you a young or old soul is how many times you've been here. And like I said, some kids actually kind of look up to the old souls, even if they physically are younger than that. Yeah, why not? There's something about the old soul's personality that attracts, you could call them young souls that come to them as for mentoring. They look up to that soul. Unfortunately, sometimes, depending on the social circumstances you're in, the younger people make fun of the young, the person who seems too old for their years. Those people, and that's what this girl Sarah in the radio was kind of going through, was a little bit of that approach that her peers saw her as an old person. Well, there's nothing wrong with being an old soul, and an old soul can still have fun. I mean, in the old soul mode, she's listening to some classical vinyl. That's classical music going on. I don't know the songs she was playing. The first one sounded like something from the 20s. It sounded okay. It sounded kind of familiar to me. But I didn't live in the 20s. No, I did. You did. Did you recognize the music? No. It was it definitely was speakeasy type music, but I don't really remember the song. Okay. The most important thing was, I did exist in 26. Yeah, you did, but you were pretty young. I was pretty young, yeah. I was in France. Yeah, we're in France, okay. Anyway, the point is, it was only in this life that Michelle lived a long life. No one knows better than Mother Osno why that was. Probably because Michele needs to learn certain skills that requires her to come back multiple times in a row. You could say do overs. I accept that. Yeah, okay. Anyway, so Michele had to come over here a couple times as do overs to learn skills throughout the different ages, which, you know, a lot of old souls go through that, and there's nothing wrong with it. What makes it interesting to watch an old soul at work, especially if they were originally trained as an engineer or a scientist or something like that, is, like I said, there's bleed through. There's skills from the past that we remember that are so instinctually part of our memories that we just do it. It's like Michele is very, very, she's still kind of got a little bit of a young soul approach to life, but she's not a young soul. She likes to try new things, but every time she does, she always tempers it with, is it really worth it? Yeah, I'm like, we were talking about the use of UVC, germicidal lighting for, germicidal lighting. Is it really worth the risk? And I thought back at my experiences with other things I've done in this life and prior lives, and I said, it's probably not worth the risk to my eyesight or to my health to mess around with these technologies. So, nah, I'll go elsewhere. So I didn't go there. Right. Now, also, there's a misunderstanding about the old soul in that video, which is that she didn't want to have fun, and old souls like to always be contemplative and quiet. There are old souls who are very much not that way. They are, you know, our party going old souls, people who enjoy, who live for the high life. They're still old souls because they've been through it. You know, they're older. They had long lives. So in other words, they didn't kill themselves off. But, you know, still enjoy the spontaneity in a moment. So, yeah, you can be an old soul and still have fun. You don't have to be old soul and always be serious. Correct. And another thing is that I'd like to just remind you that old souls are usually willing to share their knowledge with young souls. Michele has been trying to share her knowledge with the young souls around her. Okay, where were we? We were, we're talking, now I lost my place. Alright, yeah, I lost my place too. Alright, so we've covered the fact that, yes, old souls tend to get their equivalent to young souls that follow them. Usually they mentor the young souls. Old souls can be a variety of physical ages. They don't have to be children. They don't have to be adults. Same with young souls. They don't have to be children. They don't have to be adults. Old souls may have had many, many lives. By the time you have been around the block, say, I don't know how many times it's considered really old soul, but there's, you know, old souls, as I said, usually been around the block at least once. But that's not really, you could call them a young soul. I mean, a young adult soul, if you will. They've just been around the block one time only. They're not really old souls. But when you get to be Michele's number of times, 33 times, you're definitely old soul. Yeah, that's absolutely true. And then any experiences that you earn and learn and retain and use is still pretty awesome. Yep. Now, since I have you here, well, let's talk about some of the stuff that is normally not my area. I don't usually cover a lot of this, but I do want to talk about it because there's a lot of concerns. You and I study watch a lot of videos and stuff about that, about the economy and stuff like that. And there's a lot of conspiracy people talking about a variety of conspiracy topics. I want to talk to you about something that's in your genre, which is the weather. Okay. According to ADAPT 2030, he says that by the year 2017, we'll start to see the temperatures decrease perceptibly. He was using the Civil War series based around the placement of the gas giants in the solar system. Yeah. And he said that they have a strong correlation to the temperature events that have affected us in our Earth history. And I wanted to know is, what do you think is going to happen within the next 5 to 10 years? Well, you know, here's the deal. I watch those videos with a grain of salt because a lot of the stuff that we look for is based in trends analysis. Now, as we saw in the Great Potato Famine in Ireland in the 1840s and the great die-offs in the Middle Ages and the food shortages and famines, we tend to see a repeating pattern, but here's the thing that's different now versus, say, the 1600s or even, you know, pretty much the early 1840s. 1840s is more of our time, but let's talk about the difference between the 1600s and the 1840s. Just briefly see people would have an understanding of history. 1600s, our society was primarily agricultural-based. Agrarian. We had people had farms that grew food. Food was usually grown with, you know, pretty much and distributed within the small town. The farmer's family lived near. They even in the city or in the small towns or villages, people did raise their own small gardens if they had one. So they were less likely to need to buy food from produce suppliers. They could pretty much raise their own tomatoes and carrots and stuff like that. We just like see a lot of people do today. Yes. However, by the time the 1840s came around, the railroad was still in its infancy. The beginning of the Industrial Revolution was just starting to come into existence. Big towns began to grow. New York City was no small thing anyway, but it certainly grew in the Victorian era in the 1840s, as well as, of course, did London and Newcastle and Bristol and stuff like that in the UK. There was definitely more people living in smaller city environments, depending on outside food suppliers that would come into the city, say produce carts and things like that. The problem was is that there you have the beginning of the just-in-time type concept. That is, you know, you got vegetables and stuff, fruit and trucks and things are in carts that have, you know, only so many days of shelf life. So you had to sell them quickly. In fact, we found out going back to the Victorian era, there was no mass refrigeration like we have today. So getting milk into the cities, these farmers were doing a variety of nasty things to make the milk that would have gone bad because they didn't have enough ice, of using borax in the milk to lower the alkalinity of the milk and make it taste better. The problem is it didn't actually kill the bacteria that was starting to grow in the milk. It was just downright lethal. And borax itself can actually be bad for you very much, so it can actually kill you. If you're drinking kind of borax, the amount of borax that they were using in milk back in the 1840s. So that was because that was a solution to a problem, which was milk has very short lifespan. Not everybody had enough ice to keep the milk cold, and so they didn't have powdered milk at that time. That came later. now, just in time, or JIT, is how we do today. In other words, when you go into the market, you go and you say, okay, I want to buy a gallon of milk. Well, the store knows how many people are going to be buying a gallon of milk in a week. So they only order just the right amount of milk to satisfy the week's needs. They don't buy, you know, an infinite amount of milk because it costs money. Because if milk doesn't sell, you're going to have to throw it away. So the stores will only stock just the amount of milk they need. And if they see that they need more milk and the trends show, they will order more milk from the distributor, which will bring it to the store. The problem is it needs mass transit, shipping and stuff like that, in technology such as refrigerated trucks to bring it to the dairies. And all of this technology, of course, requires energy. The problem is it also requires roads and certain weather conditions can make delivery a very difficult challenge. Anybody who's been living in New York, upstate New York, last November knows doggone well what I'm saying. Challenge. When you have so much snow on the ground in Buffalo that you can barely even get anything done. Your milk would stay fresh if you put it outside, as one guy did, but it's not the point. The problem is that the distribution networks requires being able to get deliveries from the dairy to the store, distribution center, because most big supermarket chains have a distribution center that gets stuff from point A to point B and then delivers it to the individual branches. What I think is, what one guy mentioned in Adapt 2030 is that because these stores work with big dairies that make, say, for example, my area, RH Hood, Guide Us, several other smaller milk dairies that deliver the products to the major milk processing plants and then that's sold and packaged and sold to the stores. There's a layer of interconnection. Right, okay. But now, if the things get bad enough and the roads are all snowed up with snow or crop failure. Obviously, crop failure is bad. Crop failure is terrible because almost all of our foods in this country depends on a couple of basic grain staples. Corn is the most common. Wheat, barley, alfalfa, sorghum, all these products, okay, are dependent on the environment to grow. Not only do you use it for us, but we use it to feed our livestock, which we then eat. Or use the products out, like the milk and the cheese and the stuff like that, or we eat fresh meat or pork. So if the temperatures get so cold and so unreliable that they cannot successfully grow a steady supply of food, the whole system, it begins to break down. We already see this. Okay, so everything still depends on the grains. Everything depends on the grains and the grasses. Now, if there's not enough, look what happened in California. California's a good example of this. Now California's getting inundated with rain. But let's just talk about California for a minute. For 4 years of drought, 4 years of drought, it really affected the whole produce from California thing. Everything, they were so short on water in irrigation that the fields were drying out and the ground was becoming a dust bowl, all because, not only in the case of California's excessive use of water at one point, but also because there just wasn't enough water being managed properly to go to the farms. But even if you have even if you have a great source of water, you need another thing, sunlight. And if for some reason what we're talking about, what the Adapt 2030 was talking about, was how it got overcast and it was cloudy and the seeds were not germinating because it was cold, it was overcast, it was cloudy, it was yucky, the ground was too wet or the ground was too dry. That's going to affect the whole market. He said everything below, he predicts everything above 40 degrees latitude north is going to be affected. Well, yes, because that's an area, pretty much an area we're in, is It's very much depends on seasonal growth. I mean, I could grow food and say in California, in say Los Angeles, if the rain was there and the moisture was there, and everything was working properly, I could grow food even in the wintertime. But if all of a sudden, and the same thing with the Napa Valley. Okay, you can make wine. There's the reason why wine grows the way it does is because the soil is just right, the air is just right, the moisture is just right. But if the temperature drops or there's not enough sun, it's not going to make good grapes, if any grapes. And then that's going to affect the whole wine industry and also other foods that depend on growing in Northern California. So, yeah, and that's what he's talking about. He's also saying this, as other people have mentioned, this is a possibility of with reduced food output, is that people who are really hungry are going to get downright ornery and nasty. Absolutely true, and I'm not going to lie about that. But you and I know that I have been sitting there watching the news, reading the news articles, and some of the stuff I have to take with a grain of salt because I don't know much about how much. Is it really the federal government really trying to corral people into the FEMA retention camps? Is that going to happen? I can't tell you that. Are people going to starve to death? Oh, yeah, they're going to starve to death, especially in the cities. Why? Because in the cities, they don't have the resources to keep themselves fed. They depend on outside sources. And that's important to remember. Now, we see how much all this technology. I love this line from the $6 million man from the 70s, okay? We have the technology. We can rebuild him. Oh, yeah? Really? Isn't that interesting? Does not technology require energy? Yeah, energy. But you listen to people like Obama, and he's saying is, well, we need to get rid of fossil burning fuel plants. We got to get rid of nuclear. We have to get rid of coal, which is a fossil fuel. We need to go with wind and solar. Well, unfortunately, if you ever lived in New England in the wintertime right now, and I certainly have been here all my life, in this lifetime, and probably a few others, and a few other places similar to New England, because I am definitely an old soul that is more from the northern climates, you will find that is really difficult to generate enough solar energy in the wintertime in New England to imagine running machineries in captain's industry. There's just not enough sun to do it in a realistic, practical manner. You know, you'll get sunlight and you'll be able to charge your batteries, but the batteries may not have enough power to last for several days, if not possibly a week of no sun. That could happen if there's a long storm, cold snow system that comes in and it stays in one place. If you don't have an alternative backup energy source, maybe a coal-fired power plant or a natural gas-fired power plant, you're not going to be able to do much at all. You're a sitting duck. Yeah. And of course, old souls know that. Old souls would more likely know that because we went through similar things in our lives where we've seen where putting too much reliance on one thing is bad and rather has made sense to have a couple backup plans just in case something goes wrong. A nuclear power plant is not exactly the most effective way to go for backup energy source, but it certainly would make sense to keep a coal burning or natural gas power plant on standby, ready to go into service as needed. Because after all, it's easier to start up a natural gas plant than to start a coal one. But if you need to, push comes to shove, the natural gas one can be started up first while you get the coal burning plant online. So that's again where we learned from my prior lives as being as a rancher's wife is you need to have backups because you may not have access to the resources of depending on the central utility, in this case, of the power grid or any of that stuff. When you're out there in the Midwest and you're on a ranch and you have, I mean, we're talking about the 1840s. So, yeah, you're 16, by 16, 18, yeah. Okay, when I died. Okay, the point is you have to know how to take care of every possible contingency on the ranch. Because there was no LifeStar helicopters. There was no ambulances. The nearest doctor may take about 2 hours to get to your car, to your farm by buggy. He's not going to have an East EEG machine or any of the modern technology that we have today. So a lot of times, people had to be very capable of pulling through on their own. Now, the reason I died at 18 was not because of stupidity on my part, except for trying to protect my daughter Abigail from a very angry intruder. This is a human shield. Protect my 5-year-old daughter. It didn't me no good. It did her no good. Okay, we both ended up dead. But the point was, is we learn new skills. Okay, trying to protect yourself from a guy with a 22 caliber shotgun is not gonna stop you when he's going about 3 feet away from you. That bullet has an over-escape velocity that is gonna go through you with a nice clean hole, and through your newborn daughter with a nice clean hole. So it didn't take no rocket science to figure that out. That took a lot of pain. That took a lot of pain. Yes, but, okay, that's another way old souls learn. We learn from our mistakes, and then we come back and we say, okay, that was a bad move. But now we know that's the next time, if that ever happened again, the first thing I would do is, I would not try to do the same thing, act as a human shield. That wouldn't make any sense. Not at that distance. Maybe if the angry rancher was, say, about 10 yards away, because it was not, his rifle was an early board rifle. It wasn't really a really high quality one that we have today. It certainly was good at 100 yards, but the point was is that all the stuff that we're talking about is just why I think what the guy said in Adapt 2030, where people are going to go crazy, is true. Is if the government is not going to be able to stop people from going lawless, they're going to go lawless. If they see that their neighbor's got a hunk of meat, and they don't, and they're hungry, and their 5-year-old is screaming for food, the emotions get kicked in, and they're going to get that meat for the 5-year-old, even if it means taking down their best friend, and it may be their neighbor. You have to understand that human beings are very much, in modern society, we are all kind of wrapped around this kind of concept that we're supposed to be passive and docile. The only time humans are passive and docile is when everything is going fine. But when the shit hits the fan, there's not going to be no fine. Everybody's going to be out there for their own selves. And if you're in their way, they're going to get rid of you. Period. That's the sad truth. And our federal government is no different, and as well as the governments of the world. They're going to want to protect their own people. That means if they have to corral and quarantine the masses to make sure that their own government people are going to have a chance to live and enjoy the good life. That means that they have to take it from those who cannot provide. And that's exactly why living in the cities is exactly what our government's trying to do. Is it's trying to get people to want to give up their farms and their independence. And that's a bad move. But, hey, listen carefully. If by 2017 we start to see our temperatures of our Earth drop appreciably, I mean, we're talking about just 2 degrees Celsius difference could be a big problem. I mean, you're talking about how it's going to affect the crops a little bit of the world. By the way, I want to talk to you about briefly about global warming. Okay. And why it's a farce. Okay. First of all, here's why it's a farce. Number one, it's not because of man-made bullshit that we have global warming. We did. It was a solar system-wide problem. The whole solar system was seeing a rise in temperatures, not just Earth. Now, when you think about that, we don't have any developments on other planets. We haven't even gotten off this planet. We've sent probes to other planets, but we're not sending olfactories to other planets. We never sent human civilization to Mars yet. We haven't sent anyone to Venus. We haven't sent anyone to Neptune or, you know, Mercury or whatever. So why are these planets all suffering increases in temperature? Was because the sun, the big ball in the sky, that big fire star that keeps everything running, was running a little warm. And that is not a man-made event. What the International Panel for Climate Change is trying to do was trying to say and tell people that we have to cut our CO2 emissions by quite a bit to lower the temperature of the Earth. The problem is when you do that is you're also killing off the plants, because the plants need carbon dioxide, which works with photosynthesis, to produce carbohydrates that we eat later on. If you don't have any carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, photosynthesis is a waste of time. The plant is going to die. It needs that carbon dioxide, and yes, even some say carbon monoxide as well, to keep the plants process of making carbohydrates and sugars running. So you got to remember that, and we looked at even the old IPCC, this is what bothers me. They found out the temperature rise, ready for this? Within the last 100 years, it's 1/100th of a degree Celsius. Atmospheric. That's it. Oh, because of mankind. It's close to 1,000th of a degree in 100 years. Or if you want to bring it down to year, it's like 1/10,000th of a degree Celsius. And we sit there and we're trying to talk about carbon trades and carbon taxing and carbon this and carbon that. But here's the deal. Our atmosphere right now has less carbon dioxide in it than it did during the last interglacial. That's important because the Cretaceous, the Jurassic, even from 10,000 years ago, there was more carbon dioxide in the air, which helped the plants to thrive and grow and made great lots of amounts of sugars and plant mass, which later became compressed down and became coal and natural gas, which is what they do. And then you burn it and you release that. That's what they're trying to say with the IPCC, that we got to cut back on the fossil fuels. But the problem is right now what we need to do is not focus on global warming and saying the world is getting warmer, because statistically speaking, that's bullshit. It's not getting warmer. It's so much dependent on the sun. The sun is cooling down. Look at the information from the raw information from the solar observatories. You'll see this. And the problem is our government has misled the people to think that global warming is occurring. So people are not preparing for a mini ice age. They're preparing for something that's not going to come. And when the real truth hits them like a ton of shitty bricks, they're not going to have a chance because they'll freeze to death. Yeah, but isn't that what the whole goal of the Illuminati was anyway? And this is said in George's Guidestones. to get the population of the world and keep it at no more than 950 million people, what's going to happen to the other 7.4 billion? They're going to end up dead. They're going to end up dead because they're going to starve to death or they're going to freeze to death. And that is why our government is really not telling us the truth. That's why they've been stocking them on coffins. That's why they've been stocking them on FEMA camps, which have now have gas chambers in them. And they got stock cars with guillotines built into them to slice and dice on the way to the morgue. They are planning a mass cull of the Earth American population, of the people of the world, not just Earth America. And also, it's funny that at the same time is that they're trying to go through and find ways to remove the right of having gun ownership. Now, I don't have a gun. I chose not to have a gun. Okay? I don't want a gun. But I respect those who do feel they need to have a gun. You guys, I respect you. I'm not one of those anti-gun people. Okay? That was just my choice. Show me that. After all, she got shot by a gun. Yeah, I got shot by a gun because of an angry answer, but that's not the point, okay? And so we're seeing all these great things, right? And now this is an old soul talking now. This is a person who's seen this before. This is not new. This has happened before in history. It's happening again. If you read your history book of the great famines in history and the Dark Ages, they were called the Dark Ages for that exact reason. It wasn't dark because they didn't have electricity. It was dark because it was overcast and cold. It was a Dalton minimum. It actually it was Dalton. Boy, it was a long mini ice age. That did a tremendous number on everything. People tend to forget this. You can't deny that it means something. But here's the thing. Okay? Is this. You and I know this because we've been through it. And some people have. Other old souls have been through it before. They know. We know. We watch the news. We read the news. We know, of course, we're talking about the bleeds from the past. We remember this. I remember struggling trying to raise Abigail when she was very young in the cold winters of Montana. Damn, did I not forget that? Having to try to can like mad, trying to keep food in the pantry and make sure that we kept the cow's milk. We had no problem keeping the milk cold. The problem was just getting food for the cows, the grasses, the hay. And the other things that the cows needed was getting harder to get because it just wasn't easy to grow grasses in cold days. I mean, it was the time of the Irish potato famine. There's another example. I know people who suffered through that and died and came over here looking for a chance. That's why they came to a lot of them came to the cities because the United States was doing great. We had our farms, we were growing crops. Whereas everything, it was wet and rain in Ireland. They were using a tuber that was very, very sensitive to this. They came here because our soil was good, it was dry, it was nice. The West, it was good. And they came here and started families. But when they would do sending help to back home to Ireland as best they could, but even by sending family members or requests for family members to come over here, and that's how a lot of Irish did in the 1840s. The same thing with the Italians. We came over too because of the same reason. Hey, this is the green lots of land out there. It's warm. You got huge tracts of land. You can raise cattle, you can raise sheep, you can raise goats, you can grow crops. And they all came from the European area. Why? Because they didn't have a choice. It was either A, it was too hot, too dry, too barren, which was a problem anyway, or there were overfishing the Mediterranean to the point where there wasn't enough food. People were tired of that struggle. That's why they thought, go to the USA. This is a great place. You could get a start. They did. It was a hell of a marketing campaign. It really was. It was a marketing campaign. You don't hear the old expression, go west, my young man. Why not? That's exactly what they were trying to do. They were trying to get everybody to come here to go west to start towns. Now, that's great, but here's the problem. Now we're going through the same crap again, and we're going to keep going through this until one thing becomes clearly obvious. We establish what I call a conservative approach to, you know, making management live small enough towns that can provide for their own needs, but could still call on the resources of other towns that may have a surplus. Egyptians knew this. The pharaohs had warehouses. That's why they built them. Because they knew when the Nile flooded, it was going to flood out everything. Well, that's great. But it seems that our society, thanks to just in time, has basically shot itself in the foot. On the other hand, it did make sense because there was less need for warehousing, but that was exactly why we had warehouses, was to make sure that you had the material on hand of grains and milk, you know, powdered milk especially, and sugar and flour and oats and barley, so that when times were shitty, you still had that resources. And yet, before the Egyptian pharaoh realized this, that was the only way he could deal with the flooding of the Nile, was stock up the food in a warehouse. That way, when it rains out, everything's flooded, I still got food for my people. That's exactly when he started coming out with warehousing. They weren't the only ones, I can assure you, but he certainly was. We all say that Egypt was the cradle of civilization. Of course, it turns out the whole Middle East was. A good portion of it was the cradle of civilization. Everything has a cyclic trend, according to ADAPT 2030, and he's right. And you're going to see this again and again and again. And part of the problem is it's like old souls that never learn. They're going to keep coming back again and again and again and again until they get it through their heads that they need to prepare. These people are doing the same thing. The problem is we always say we have the technology. Yeah, but that technology still depends on resources that are not going to help us. Thank you very much for that answer. And for the rest of you guys, I know I haven't done many videos, but I want to hear your opinion. So please contact me at the comment section below here at lumifinistra@gmail.com or, of course, on Google Plus as plus lumifinistra or, of course, in the comment section below here. And we'll talk about this. There's a lot of stuff to go through. Michele, I thank you very much for taking the time to go through and cover so much. I don't even usually think of half this stuff. Michele has always give me things to think about, even when I don't really have the time to really chew through it all. You're welcome. Okay, guys, that's it for now. Thank you very much for watching. I'll see you soon. Bye-bye, guys. Bye.